Welcome back, everyone. So we are going to start our first talk of the day. So it's called Consuming Government Data with Python and D3. I guess that would be interesting because data visualization nowadays is quite booming. So to give an introduction of our speaker, so he's Pratap Vardhan. So Pratap is a data scientist at Graminer.com, a data analytics and visualization company, and he has done his BTech from NIT Bhopal. So before we start the talk, just again, a few quick announcements. Again, I'm reiterating the same facts. Don't create Wi-Fi hotspots, please. And plus you can check out the open space availability, and if you want to propose a talk or something, you can do that. Make sure you ask for the feedback forms from the volunteers who are there so that we can have the feedback for this talk. And also the registration for lightning talks are going on outside. So there's a board, you can just clip in your topic, whatever you want to speak during the lightning talks, or get in touch with one of the volunteers, so they'll help you out. So first talk, over to you, Pratap.
Sure. With Python and D3, and in Python do I mean in all the Python libraries, but no. In this talk, mostly I'll focus on how do we use pandas. It's just one of the data crunching libraries, and also D3 based frameworks which lets you do some interactive visualizations. And all this talk is form of an IPython notebook which is there on GitHub, and I might have just tweeted right now. And so if you just want to run through the examples with yourself on your system, you can just download the notebook and just run it across. All the data sets of this talk are up on GitHub and you can just use that. Now, let me start off with what is it that is very particularly interesting about government and data. And rather than me saying it, I would just use Calvin. What would he think of, why would he need government in a sense? This is one of the reasons which even I particularly think why it's pretty important, as in, not that I'm doing any good for the government or with the data, but rather I want to have a powerful say, or heck, I just want to run the things. Of all the things that you do with the government, which are the couple of things that you think are pretty much connected to you? Can I just have 3-4 words which connects when you talk about government data? Let's see if we capture that today. Just shout out, any shout out. Okay. We have sensors. Okay, we have a lot of. Okay. Let's see if we try to answer some of these things. But before even getting into the formation of government and all, before anyone gets into form the government, the first thing they do is launch a political party. For the political party to survive, the next thing you would need is some money, which is probably like you want to do a fundraising session, right? So you want to collect some donations. Unfortunately, in India, the data of political donations is not pretty much open. Although we do have some parties or some sources of information where we can do some analysis. Interestingly, there was this one particular party which sort of published their donations on their own website. However, there was a tricky part. The donations were not form of a data set. Rather, it was part of a ASP website where you have to scrape the data by clicking next and so on. And which is a little tricky again because dealing with ASP websites, especially for scraping, involves some sort of understanding because they don't store the query parameters that well. Any guesses which is the party that I'm talking about? Right. So the way we did it was take the data, keep scraping the data, and after a week or let's say a daily update, instead of scraping the data again from the bunch, let's just take the delta of the information. So you just have the last updated date when you scrape the information. Just take the list of the next 100 records or 200 records, whatever it could be, and then start updating the DB. So the DB, as you see, it will be in the data folder with appdonation.db, which is available in the repo also. And the one thing that you need to notice here is, let's forget how we would usually do it with Python. Let's assume the pandas didn't exist. You would have number of steps. Even to read a simple CSS file or to do simple group by or to do some aggregations, it involves certain amount of lines of code. Most of the talk you would see here, all the aggregations are all sorts of any sort of analysis that we'd be doing would involve just a single line of code without any involving any single line of for loop. I guess you would appreciate why we are not using for loop in Python, at least when you're doing data analysis. So the simple thing, I've just read the data, and the data that I have currently has name, country, state, and a transaction ID. Like the moment you make a donation, they give you a transaction ID. You have certain amount of, the date stamp also is recorded. To just to get a feel of the data, the total, at least to the period of last month, August or something, in about 80 crores has been donated to this party, and there were about 2 lakh donations being made. And an average amount that has been donated was around 3,000 rupees. I mean, if you were to think of this like a 3-year-old startup, which started off, and it got crowdsourced funded by 2 lakh people, almost raised close to ₹1 billion. But that's a rosy picture. We are looking at a very high level and saying, commenting all this, but let's get into further details. What is that we can actually look into? I hope the next slides will have a bigger font, but there's nothing I could do because it's just responsive this way. I'll see what I can do about it. So some of the things that we just saw was like, which they keep talking about, you know, the donations coming in were usually between a certain amount of donation, like it's either 1,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees, but not large amounts. In a peculiar case, you have Bajaj Electoral Trust, which actually donated close to 3 crore rupees. This was the single largest donation made to that party, and it was around 2014, and right after the election, or around the election time. But what's interesting to notice, if we were to consider, if you donate money to anyone, and if you're donating more than 1 lakh rupees, that's pretty much like you must be super rich, or that you can afford to donate so much amount of money. And if I were to pull out the information, the donations which are more than 1 lakh, and what was that sum? I mean, what was that amount of donations which came in which were more than 1 lakh? So people who have donated, so only 400 odd people at least have donated quarter the amount of money. Out of the 2 lakh that we have been considering, it's just that 400 super rich people have donated quarter amount of money. And so pandas gives you some sort of reasonably good functions, like to deal with any time series data, you have resampling methods, or to do group by, you have group by. I'll talk about the importance of using resampling, especially in the context of when you're dealing with time series data, and why it's really fast. If you look at this data, what we have simply done is we have taken the data set, set the index to date, taken the amount, and resampled on month, and taken the sum of it. So this is sort of month on month value that we're getting for Aam Aadmi Party. This is good, fine, I'm getting the data, but this doesn't look that good because what do I make sense of it? I just need to read the numbers. I don't know where it is growing or where it is going down. Likewise, we also take in count, most number of times we just focus on the absolute figures, like what is the sum, but we don't focus on content like how many donations were coming. At certain periods of time, you would actually see it was just because of one or two people, there was a spike in the amount. Or when is a popular perception of public that they were actually donating a lot amount of money? Now, what you notice here is, instead of me doing this in two different functions or two lines of code, here I'm trying to do get the amount as well as the count in a single line of code using the how method, where I could actually define the NumPy parameters or the functions which lets you tell either on this column, you need to do sum or a mean or standard deviation or all sorts of any aggregation method you want to use. Now, one thing that I've noticed, like this was the one thing that I sort of skipped actually when I did this analysis, was when you sort of do any sampling or resampling, you have something called as, at least in machine learning, called cursive dimensional reduction, which sort of tells you that if you have a lot many features, your model is sort of not pretty good. Probably we could also argue that at least from a visual perception or trying to get the initial insights, if we don't sample the data at a proper frequency, we might lose out on some key information. Now, if you notice, the data that's been presented here, it's almost identical. It's the same data, it's just some amount of money, but it's just that on one I've done it on daily basis aggregation, on other I've done it on monthly basis aggregation. On the daily basis, when I did it, if you notice on 2014 July, there was a huge spike. And actually, when I do it on monthly, it was generally during the election period where the spike was. So the July period was because there was a single donation from Bajaj that actually spiked up this information. Now, all this is good. How do we get into actually doing some interactive visualization? So one thing, or one of the things that pretty much helped me a lot was to use JavaScript or D3. Now, how do I combine this JavaScript and Python into this? You would have other frameworks like Tornado or Flask where you pump in the information and then you can render the information on output. But what if I don't want to do all of that? I just want to focus on my IPython notebook. I don't want to do any of, you know, other interactions or any other overheads. So here is one simple way where you can actually include JavaScript into a notebook. So IPython provides you with certain functions where it can inject HTML into it. All that I'm doing is I'm just passing a string. What that string does is you're initially defining a HTML tag, which is a time identified by a time ID. All that I'm doing is take a date, current date, and every half a millisecond, keep updating that value. So you would notice there is some sort of, you know, the time gets updated. Right now it's 10:55. I'm almost like 10 minutes past since I've started my talk. Now, this is good. So there is something that I can dynamically change the value in the browser without having to stop my console. So I can move on to the next piece of code without having to do that. So how do we bring visual into this? To use D3 or to use other frameworks like C3 or Dimple, you could use, again, require config where you can import these libraries. So the moment you do this, D3 and Dimple is sort of like, you know, loaded into your browser and you can access these variables, or like you can call them as their internal functions to do all sorts of plotting that you want to do. Now, one example, if you were to use D3, it's a very low-level language, especially if you're very good with or very imaginative with your visualizations, you could do all sorts of things. So here, simply what we're doing is defining a SVG with a width of 600 and 300, and next I'm putting a rectangle, which I'm defining it as square, at a position 30 and 30. Later, if you remember the auto time update that we have written two slides back, I'm using a similar function, but I'm just replacing the X and Y with a random value. So it starts as a position 30-30, but slowly after every 2 seconds, it keeps moving around. So all this is happening in IPython notebook, and I'm not stopping it, nor I'm controlling it. Now you can imagine if I have this control or flexibility that once I have the data, I've pushed it out, and now let the JavaScript behave however it wants to. It could be me, like, you know, hovering on some element that will give me a tooltip, or I could use a brush or a filter to narrow it down. Now, to give a sense of what sort of visualizations we could do, here is one example. I mean, I've just included the link that we have used. I'll just walk through some of the features that we used. Yeah, so if you notice here, all the aggregations, the backend crunching is done in pandas, and once you visualize it on the browser, the way it comes out, we are primarily talking about a summary section that sort of updates every time you select any different filters. And all this is auto-annotated, whatever you want to give, like if at all you want to speak about what are the donations coming from certain state or so on. To make it more intuitive, we thought, like, what is it that people, okay, looking at charts is fine, but this is something to do with politics, and some commentary would be interesting. So if you notice here, there is some sort of spikes coming at certain periods of time, or there was some dip. So generally when he began strike, or like, okay, this was related to the power bills issue, there was a spike in the number of donations. And this was the day when, I guess, the election was announced. Then there was a huge spike. Then it formed a minority government. The moment Kejriwal announced that he will take on Modi, sort of, there was a huge spike. And when the moment people got to know, okay, we bet on a wrong horse, and actually Modi won, and there was collapse in donations. But there was one spike. That spike was due to the Bajaj. So we might actually think that, no, that could be wrong. But as we go back in the data and see, it was not because of usual public perception. But you would notice, again, in 2015, there was another election called for. There was, again, spike in donations. And they were literally, it has fallen down. And other sort of visuals that you see here, this is called some sort of a tree map visualization, where the size of the rectangle represents the total amount of donation made from that group. It could be from Delhi, how many donations are coming, what's the sum of it. And the color sort of represents what's the average value. It might so happen that Delhi could be donating a lot of amount of money, but it might have been donated by a lot many people. So the average that they donated could be 1,000. So it's actually Maharashtra and NRIs, where average donations is much higher than Delhi. And so, but how do we get to that crux of information that we could actually put a visual? All that I need is for every state, I need information of what is the total donation amount, what is the average amount, what could be the total number of, or the mean of it, or the average of it. And one way of doing it is, again, using group buys. So here, what I've done is just taken, do a group buy on state, take the amount, and write an aggregation function which does the sum, a count, and mean of it, and just sort on count. That's it. It's a single line code. All that you have to do is call a data frame, that's like your tabular data, and just do some aggregations. All that you wanted to display in a tree map is right in front of you. So it's just single line of piece of code. The same thing, again, could be done for countries. Although might be interesting to see that their data set sort of classifies India also as a country, and you might have to remove that data. So for filtering something, all that you have to do is use square brackets and put a condition that I don't want a country where it is India. So all that I want is a set of rows where country is not India. And the moment you get that, again, you chain it with another group by function on country, and then you write your aggregate functions, and then you do all sorts of, either you want to sort it based on count, or you want to do it on mean, or a total number of donations. So in countries, if you notice, it's the United States that has the highest number of donations coming in. And then you have UAE, UK, Singapore, Canada, Australia. This is fine and interesting. I mean, probably usually expected because a lot of NRIs are coming from these countries. But if you notice, the large amount of, you know, less people donating, but they're donating large amount of money are actually coming from Hong Kong. So I don't know what's happening in Hong Kong. It could so happen that there have been 161 donations. On an average, they've sort of donated more than like 1.5 lakh or something. But the biggest of all, where single donation has come from Somalia. We keep talking that, okay, some conflict in Somalia, but it does seem like, at least when it comes to politics of our country, people going there and working in all that, you know, all the issues that they're facing with, they're still able to save up some money. What's rather more interesting is, it's not just, you don't see any top countries figuring in the average donation countries. All you see is Trinidad and Tobago, Turkey, Indonesia. So you have all sorts of countries that you don't expect where people would be donating in high amount, or at least individuals donating in high amount, they actually do. And the good part is now, if I want to see what is actually happening with Hong Kong, or what is it that they're doing, probably I can just click. Okay, I don't have the internet. Okay, we'll get back to that. Now, so all that we have done so far is we have used the data as it is. We haven't created any data. We haven't really seen into what else could we actually deal with the data. We have taken the amounts, we have taken the countries, and we have taken the cities. Is there something that we could actually, you know, create new data from the existing data? So one such thing that we did was, what about, you know, I'm not interested whether the guy paid 2 rupees or 10 rupees. For me, anything between 1 to 100 is the same amount, like he's making a small donation. So let's sort of bucket them into bins of 100, 500, 1,000, and then so on. So now I've sort of wanted to see the distribution of it. You do a histogram, you get the sort of values that you want. And okay, one note, Pandas inherently has NumPy as well. So you can, all that you need to do is by accessing like pd.np. So all the NumPy functions that you want to have, you could get it from that. So the histogram that we used here was for coming from NumPy. The next, so we sort of created a new column called amount bucket, where I'm saying cut the amount on these bins and explicitly mentioning that right is equal to false, which means that do not consider the value on the right. So whatever is 100, if it is 100, it actually comes to the next bucket, not 1 to 100. So what we just did here was we created metadata, or we created a new information that didn't exist. Probably it might be interesting to see what is it that we can do with this data. The first thing probably we would be interested to see is, from the states that are donating, where is it that people are actually donating in 1 rupees and 100 rupees? Like, you take all the pain coming to the internet using your credit card, whatever, and you donate 1 rupee. I guess probably your internet cost and data charges would be more than 1 rupee, but you're still investing your time to come and donate 1 rupee. So which are those states where people are actually coming out and voting with those amounts? So again, a simple aggregation would let you do, you know, do it on state, get the amount bucket, and get a count of it, and you would see, you know, at least in Andhra Pradesh, a lot of amounts are actually coming from 1,000 to 5,000, not bad. And if you go to certain other states, especially there was a case where Uttar Pradesh leads in actually donating small amounts. People are fascinated with, you know, giving denomination. What's more interesting is people have donated every single amount that exists between 1 to 100, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you keep counting. The moment they see a sheet of donations that they've made, and if they've sorted by mistake, they would see, okay, why am I getting 67 rupees? How would someone even donate 69 rupees or 72 rupees? In fact, it's not just 1 to 100. If you go from 1 to 200, there are just four values missing. People have donated every single amount that exists. What's more bizarre, actually, people are even superstitious in their donations. You would see that there are donations like 111, 222. That's fine, fancy number. But you have numbers like 2014, 2015. Probably auspicious year. They think that, you know, if you donate on auspicious year, it would be good. But there's a mindset. Probably people think it's just generally people in the low income groups do this sort of donations. But you've seen instances where there were donations coming in, actually coming in more than 1 lakh rupees. They've actually given with 1,000 something and the date on which they've donated. So it's 1,23,014 something, so on. So you have all those weird sort of numbers that are coming in. And this is interesting, as in it at least tries, I mean, at least, although we can try and extrapolate at least how people react and people sort of say something, at least from their donations, can we talk something about the psychology or our psychology? Now, all that we are doing so far is to do pivots, but this is not very interesting, because if I want to compare something from an age bucket with other states, what I would rather do in Excel is call pivots, right? Now, the same thing I could do it in pandas as well. All that I need to do is call pivot and do it on which, what is the index? I'm doing it on state, and I'm doing it on columns, which is called amount buckets, and take the values of amount of transaction IDs and just do a count of it. Now, I've got it for all the states, for all the amounts, I've got amount of values. Now, it might be very easy if I just put a heat grid for every value that exists here. I just need to put a color and then see what is it that I can see. Now, most of the times, you don't want to see all this information. All that you want is to focus only on the top five states and then do this sort of a pivot and then do a heat grid on top of it. So, to filter that, if you remember, initially we have taken ARP states as a variable where we define the top 10 states. Now I'm saying in the DF state, even the syntax is very, very much readable, that you can say, in the ARP states, take the top 10 and check wherever the DF state is at, and I just want that data frame and do a pivot on it. I get it. Now all that I just need to do is put some sort of a heat grid on it. And the moment you do that, you get some sort of a pattern where you see Delhi has a lot of donations coming from 100 to 500. There are a lot of values, or there's actually an anti-pattern that you might see. Apart from barring out NRIs, Karnataka actually donates a lot of, you know, 1,000 to 5,000 probably from Bangalore because, you know, IT or whatever fan base they have. Now, so far we've been talking about, you know, the good parts or the good analysis or like, you know, which feels as good if you have donated to this party. What if there's something mischievous or something that, not intentionally wrong, but the data is probably pointing us to some funny things. Like, whenever you make a donation, you're getting a transaction ID that is supposed to be very unique to you, right? You're not supposed to give multiple, same transaction IDs to multiple people. Now, it so happened that when you try to find out, I just took on the transaction IDs, give me the value counts, and try to find out wherever the transaction IDs is more than one. Now you would notice like Anil P. Wilson, and I'll be reading out few of the names. If you're lucky enough, if you're in the room, just raise your hand. So we have Anil P. Wilson, who's donated certain amount of money and on particular date, and you would notice that it's actually the same date, same amount. Might have so happened that the bank has actually tried to credit the same amount again. Maybe the database actually recorded it twice. I don't know, something is happening where people's names are getting duplicated. So could be some issue at their end, let them figure out what it was. But what if they're actually different people? You have transaction IDs, like the first one, if you see, Tushar Shah and Harish Kumar Sharma, although they were born at different places, they were connected with the same TIDs. And the you sort of see these people, like, you know, it's a weird thing, you know, you and I are connected with this TID. And the other thing that you would notice is this is some legacy issue probably, because all the donations that were made during 2013 had this issue or had this blip where they were giving the same transaction IDs to these people. Probably later they figured out what might have happened and they probably moved to, you know, something better, or they must have fixed it. Although also while noticing this, you might actually have seen, if you have the access to the database, open the DB and write a simple SQL query, where you would notice there's a donations that are missing during 2013, November to December for 15 days or 20 days. I'm not sure whether they wiped it off or the database didn't record or something could have happened, but for those 10 days, because there hasn't been a single day since the inception that there hasn't, I mean, there has always been a donation, be it even 1 rupee or whatever be the amount, but for those 20 days, there was no donation. Now, like, you know, we all have fun. When you're deeply connected with politics, especially if you're in Twitter, you know how people react to things. So I don't know who did this, but it seems a lot of people wanted Narendra Modi to donate to AAP. I'm pretty sure he might have not. But you see a lot of people actually in the name of Narendra Modi, and actually one person even wrote Narendra Modi for AAP, and he has actually donated. But the interesting thing is, they're not donating much, 1 rupee, 5 rupees. The problem is trying to make a point, or they'll take a receipt and show it to their friends, or, you know, this is what I did today. But that's not it. A lot of fans of Kejriwal also try to do the same thing, but if you have access to the slides, you can go through some of the names which are pretty funny. I don't want to read that out loud. Just to give you some sense, it's 17362 says Kejriwal Nautanki. Then, you know, but yeah, fine. I mean, you can't do anything with trolls, so they just keep doing this stuff. Again, in the same thing, you know, the donations are largely less. It's not huge amounts that people are actually donating. Then we get international people into our politics. You have Osama bin Laden, you have Obama, then you have Hitler. We just don't leave at Hitler. We just want to make statements like Hitler lover Arvind Kejriwal. I mean, people get real creative, but if you notice, again, the same thing. It's just 1 rupee. So I guess a lot of people are actually donating 1 rupee. Probably they're trying to make a point, you know, I can fool with the system, or I'm just checking before I make a big amount. Let me check if this actually goes through. Now, fine, this all has been fun. Like, you know, you can creep along, like, you know, we have this data, this is what you're doing. But at least good part, the data is out. You can play around and do something with it. So what if you get elected and you start becoming the prime minister of the country or chief minister, you start doing things, and media obviously reports for the things that you do. What is the most famous thing that you remember of the ex-PM Manmohan Singh? Anything? Pretty good. I guess everyone agrees that he's very silent, right? Let's see if he was really silent or someone cooked up the data. Now, I'll let you read this later, but actually this is more important, actually, because what it says is, I know more about the private lives of celebrities than I do about any government policy that will actually affect me, right? I'm interested in things that are none of my business, and I'm bored by things that are important to know. The media aim to please. I'll leave that at that point and let you fill in with whatever you like. Now, the data, again, the same thing. So the PMO had this site called PMO Speeches. Right now it got moved to archive or something, and we had to scrape all the speeches. Like, it had a unique ID, a link, and you have to scrape all that information, and all that you get is an ID, date, on which he gave the speech, the place, the full content of the speech, and the title of the speech, and the place when place to are the meta information that we added, whether the state or the country and et cetera. So since you anyway said he's very silent, I'll not ask the answer what could be your guess. I'll be silent for a moment, let you read what this actually says. I guess whoever said that he's pretty silent, right? He actually gave a speech every 3 days. I guess most of us would never do that, right? Giving a speech every 3 days. In all, he has given 1,200 odd speech in a span of 10 years. That's about every speech every 3 days. That's pretty high. But it would be interesting to actually see, did those speeches really occur? Or were they just press statements? Or where were they actually given? When were they actually given? We have the data, right? So all that we do need to do is, you know, group by on time or group by on date and states and extract some information. Now, all that we have done here is we've just taken the data frame, did a group by on time, extracting the year part. Now, since I'm not working on timestamps directly, and I just took, you know, the count of it. You got some values, which may not be very revealing because we are not actually trying to compare these. I've sort of used a DimpleJS library where I've just sort of injected some information. All that I did was pass a JSON object. X is based on years and Y is based on speeches, and just put the geom object as a bar, right? Now, so it seems like in 2008, he gave almost like 218 speeches. That's actually more than a speech almost every 1.5 day, I guess, right? If you remove Saturdays and Sundays, it's almost like, I guess, even public holidays and other holidays, a speech every day. Every night probably must be preparing the speech, and next day is going in and giving it up. But we keep hearing that he doesn't talk, right? We haven't heard of him much, we don't see him, and it's true because we have rarely seen him speak. But the peculiar thing that to notice here is, as when his tenure began in 2004, and from 2008, it's the number of times he spoke, or like his speeches kept increasing, like 2006, five, six, and seven. And you remember there was a second election in 2009. I don't know what might have happened. They might have thought that, you know, it's time to probably, you know, pull back Manmohan Singh and push some fresh person into the party. And probably that's the reason they sort of try to push the speech content to the other person. Now, people are best judges to what happened to those speeches by that person, but I'll leave it to the point where since 2009 onwards, they've been pretty much stagnant. You know, the number of speeches have been pretty less, and he's been content to himself. Now, all that we have done is done a group by, right? I keep mentioning about using resampling. Now, resampling is pretty fast. Like, if you're using IPython, you can just use this magic command, time it, and measure the time that it takes. So almost it takes 18 microseconds to do if I were using group by. If I just do it using resampling, I would do it at like, you know, 6x speed. And both the values are actually identical. So takeaway is generally if you're dealing with any time series data and all that you want to do is, you know, measure some quantity based on dates, hour-wise or month-wise or week-wise, it's pretty good to use resampling. Now, we have seen that since when he started speaking and where all he spoke, which were the top places or where was he speaking the most? Any guesses again? I guess this will be pretty easy. Louder? Parliament. I guess that will take it as Delhi. But do you know what could be the proportion that in Delhi you must have spoken X amount, outside of Delhi it could be this much? Any rough idea? 80-20, 80 in Delhi and 20 outside. So that's pretty huge, right? So he's a Delhi man. He should have been the... So it turns out that actually in Delhi he gave 760 speeches. The second that came closest was actually Maharashtra and then US. Funny thing is, after New Delhi and after like Maharashtra, the popular places that he went to was USA, Russia, Japan. And there are few countries, you know, Assam probably is his home state from where he got himself nominated. At least he went there. But South Africa was more popular than Assam. And there were actually few countries, there were few places that he hasn't actually visited. And so we could do all these sorts of things, like how many unique places that he has been to. We get some sense of an idea how many places that he has visited. In 2006 was the maximum where he visited like 50 places. That's the best thing. Today we keep talking about Modi has been visiting a lot of foreign nations. I guess once the data is out, we can even compare with this and see which one is going where. Now, we have text information as well, right? So what is it that we can do with the text? String methods are something that even pandas provide. So all that we need to do is measure the length of the text and then see what's the, how is this variation? As you notice, again, year-wise, if you go, after 2006 or something, the length of the speech also decreased. So there were cuts both ends. You cannot speak more, and the number of times you'll speak also will be less. Or it's a self-put rule, or I don't know from where it came. Now, the next thing I just want to talk, so far we've been talking about, you know, the data that we can scrape from somewhere where data is not readily available. But we have some nice initiatives, like data.gov does provide some good data sets. What is it that we can do with other data sets? One of the data sets that is working this week was exports and imports. So all that, I'll just skim through some of these slides. You can just look them up, how to read these. The interesting things that we noticed was where were your major exports and, you know, imports coming from. Obviously, exports were exporting more to UAE, USA, China, and the imports were actually coming from China anyway. But how do I merge these two? Then I would probably sort of need to do merge or a join of these two operations and then try and see what is it that I can compare. This is how you would merge two data sets, doing a concatenation of the two, because both are series and I could join them on those keys. But so where is it that my exports are pretty high? And if I were to sort on that ratio of exports by imports, you would get it's UAE where, you know, you're exporting a lot, but it's almost in the 1:1 ratio. USA, we actually export more than we import, but there are certain countries, China, for example, we actually import more than we export. Now, all this is good. You have certain methods to do it. And what's interesting, what I found more interesting was you have information for what commodities are we actually trading. So we would assume that any commodity we import or we export, we won't do the both, right? I mean, if I'm importing petrol, why would I export it again? Because I need it, why would I actually buy and sell it again? If you notice some of these examples, cashews, we actually export a lot of cashews, but there is some sort of a shelled cashew that we actually import. Now, I don't know what that special variety is that people want to import, but there are some glaring examples where we actually import and export as well. For example, petrol, we all know that we actually import a lot of petrol. That's the reason for the fluctuation in dollar as well. But why would we export? Could it be a reason that you're actually buying someone and selling it to someone at a higher price? We just need to look at all these policies. Interesting thing, at the bottom if you see wheat, we would assume that we are exporting. At the very rarest of case, if you're importing wheat, which means that we have made some policy that we thought we have surplus of our wheat and we have actually exported it, and later realized that our country doesn't have enough wheat and we import. Now this data sort of, you know, lets us look at more meaningful way that if our policies are working or not. Now, this was again a simple representation. I'll just skim through this. And I'll try and touch upon crops bit a bit, because we keep talking about, you know, all so far in the media, we hear very less about farmers or what's that make concern. So I just want to touch upon two topics, which are more about crops and rainfall. So in the crops area, similar sort of analysis we just carried out, try to do some aggregations if at all you can find some patterns. What we noticed was the data was incomplete. All that you required to find out how is it I can extract the anomalies in the data was you just try to extract how many unique crops I'm actually getting in the data set for every year. For some reason, in the year 2002 and 2003, there were a lot of crops. The other data sets were not coming in. So there was a mismatch in this data. And I'll skim through this. And I guess I'm a bit out of time. So I'll skim through this and just take it up when you have the notebook in your hands. I'll just touch upon the last point, which is more about telling data stories. So once we have the data, and once we have the visuals that we want to tell, I just can't put them simply in form of, you know, data and then a visual and describe it. There must be some intuitive way that people can understand. It could be form of, if you're hard publishing in a newspaper, you can't do much about it. But when you have a powerful medium like web, where you have all sorts of things that you could do in terms of interactivity, one thing that we tried to do was sort of how do you blog this? All that we have was a census information. The data points we had a state. What is the percentage of households who were having bikes, who were having smartphones, who had land, water, all sorts of different variables we had. So the data story that we wanted to tell was, you select your x-axis, you select your y-axis, and radius and color also varies based on that. All that you just need to do is select anything. So if I were to change this to percentage of four-wheelers, the data sort of moves with it. So you do see which are the states that are actually moving. This is fine, but I don't know anything to start with. Could you actually tell me a story? Fine, let's write a story. We'll start with some of the data points or insights that we initially identified. I'll talk about, okay, though we may think that irrigation equipments would be higher where who are having a lot of irrigated land, but it turns out there are a lot of exceptions. So you do see this a regression, I mean, sort of a regression pattern, but there are some outliers in the east and the west, right? So, and like you could tell your story, insert your concept over there, and once the person comes over to that piece of text, the visual is sort of to be refreshed. So he sort of knows that, you know, for some reason, it's especially if you're working in a telecom sector, this must be a good interesting data point. The belt, specifically Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and Orissa, has the lowest mobile penetration, irrespective of rest of India. Yeah, so in all, so we have a lot of data coming out from the government. Some could be very messy. You just need to find means to find out how is it that I can do. You could marry some data sets. It could be crop or rainfall and combine them to tell some stories. But we would come at a point that some information is incomplete. We might have to deal with, you know, taking help of some methods, like how do you extrapolate or interpolate or fill these values with some of the methods that we have walked through. The important part, however, would be we have all sorts of tools that we would like to play with. We are actually having good hold of data, at least in the recent years, we are getting good amount of data, it's being made public. Probably we just need some imagination and concern for the data that's coming out, that we could tell some stories so that we are not blinded by the media and we can do something our own. Thanks. I'll just have some few minutes. If you have any questions, I can just take them.
So those visualizations are coming. So which tool you are using, like any packages or any JavaScript?
Okay, I guess I've mentioned in the beginning, for some of the charts that you've seen in the IPython notebook were done using D3 or DimpleJS.
Okay.
Those were JavaScript-based libraries. Otherwise, you do have Matplotlib in Python itself, okay, which is pretty good for exploratory. But for interactivity and stuff, you might need, you know, to use these libraries.
Okay, for these kind of things, like the amount of text that is highlighted, it will show the amount, means that part only to visualize. Means the second paragraph we are highlighting, so the data related to only second part will be highlighted, like you are doing here. So
yeah,
how can we do that?
Basically, if you notice, all the filters on the top, it's
okay,
URL driven, okay? The
okay,
moment
okay,
I come to any section,
yeah,
the URL gets changed, and based on the URL, the visual gets refreshed. So I sort of push new data once the URL changes,
okay,
and the data gets refreshed.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hi.
I'm Vamsi. I've been working on a similar problem set. Basically, I'm dealing with healthcare data. So I have a small Flask server which just serves JSON content to Angular front end. There I'm using D3 and cross filters to display the data. One of the bottleneck I've been hitting is the amount of data which I need to push out. So there should be some form of streamable, the JSON should be streamable. Yeah. And one such thing I've come across was bokeh plots. Have you ever used it? And if you have, what are the advantages or disadvantages?
Okay, I haven't used bokeh because I use D3. So pretty much solves my problem. But at a high level, when your principle is again the same behind both these things. Like you just, instead of passing all the data that you want, for the amount of visuals that you need to represent, you just pass that amount of data. The thing is, if I put a scatter plot, all that information that I need is just the state name, the x value, y value, and the radius, right? Even if you pass like 100 rows of information, I cannot display 100 rows of data because you cannot even consume that. As much as possible, probably when you're working with real-time streaming, you would only pass the aggregates which would come into the browser. That would actually save so that you can actually have control on the data that gets passed.
Actually, the data ID
just to interrupt you guys, can you take these questions outside or
sure.
offline? Because we are ready for the next talk. So sorry to interrupt, but yeah. So can we have a round of applause?
Thank you.
For such a fantastic talk by Ashutosh.